This is Rabbi David Eidenson, author of the book Secret of the Scale on Marriage and Human Relations. Our website is secretscale.com. We want to talk today about Orthodox Jews. In a previous video, we discussed Haredim. Those are the ultra-Orthodox, and today we want to talk about Orthodox. The Orthodox are people that keep the laws stated in the Torah, in the Bible, and in the Talmud. They are not Haredi in the sense the Haredi wear the long black coats and wear beards. That's the ultra-Orthodox. The Orthodox keep the Shabbos, keep the Sabbath, keep the holidays, they eat kosher food, they pray every day, and they are Orthodox. Basically, Orthodoxy comprises various segments of Orthodoxy. There are the Haredim, who are basically Orthodox, that they keep the Torah, just as Orthodox Jews do. And then there's the moderate Orthodox, and then there's the modern Orthodox. When we said in our previous video that the future of the Jewish people will be Haredi, some studies have been done which show the Haredi element growing, some say 6% a year, they'll double every 11 years, and some say by 250 they'll be the majority of Jews. There's a question: what will happen to the Orthodox who are not Haredim? And we want to discuss this today. What about the Orthodox who are not Haredim? In Europe, there were two basic groups: the Eastern European and the Western European Jews. Both were Orthodox, but the Western Europeans, such as the German Jews, the Frankfurt Jews, the followers of Rabbi Shishim Bufel Hirsch, people who went to college, the rabbis had doctorates, but they were deeply Orthodox, and they joined together. Indeed, they were the founders and the workers in the famous Haredi ultra-Orthodox rabbi-led Agudat Israel. So you have today in Agudat Israel, that was founded by the Chofetz Chaim, many years ago, a couple generations ago, this organization includes the German Modern Orthodox, the disciples of Rav Shishim Bufel Hirsch, and it also includes Hasidic rebbes and major Rosh Yeshivas. So therefore, we see here in the ultra-Orthodox Haredi camp, different types. There's Ashkenazim, European, there are Sephardim from the Mediterranean base, these are all Haredim. And then you have to include among the Haredim the Germanic element of the Frankfurt School of Shishim Bufel Hirsch, because they basically are Haredim, even though they dress like other people, but they are still Haredi. And indeed, going back 100 years, there were people in Jerusalem who shaved, who were considered Haredim. They were the yeshiva students. In those days, the yeshiva students from Eastern Europe, most of them shaved. The Hasidic students did not, but the non-Hasidic students shaved. So we see that there's different types of Haredim. But we want to talk today about different levels of Orthodox. And we find here a very interesting situation. And nobody knows exactly what will happen, because there's great tension, and always was great tension. If we go to, say, to Yeshiva University. Yeshiva University was the first yeshiva founded in America, and it was founded to provide a rabbinate to Americans. And they needed a college-educated rabbi. We're going back maybe 100 years. There were many great rabbis in America, but the community was basically devoid of Orthodoxy, because you couldn't keep the Sabbath, because people had to work 6 days a week. They had to work on Saturday. So Orthodoxy was in very great peril. And there, a few heroic people founded Yeshiva University in the teeth of the storm, when it was impossible to be Orthodox. And subsequently, Teravadas was founded, Chaim Volin, other yeshivas were founded as well. But the beginning was Yeshiva University, and this became known as the Modern Orthodox. And it was a very interesting combination of opposites. In the Talmudic department of Yeshiva University, you had the greatest geniuses of East European, Lithuanian rabbis, such as Rabbi Yosef Bar Soloveitchik, who was a descendant of the great rabbis of the Brisker Rabbonim, the Brisker rabbis. And he was a great Talmudic genius. And yet he had he was also very brilliant in other areas as well. But many of the rabbis there were simply Talmudists. They had no degrees in secular learning. Then you had the professors who were brilliant professors. Many of them were atheists, and the students went half day to study with Rabbi Soloveitchik and the East European Moshe Shivas and rabbis, and then they studied colleges with college secular studies with atheists. And this came out of confusion. You have a lot of people there that had a lot of confusion, because it's very difficult to marry the two things, the atheism and the religion. And indeed, what happened at Yeshiva University was that there was a split. There were people even led by rabbis who were very close to the college level, and there were people very close to Rabbi Soloveitchik's level. And during his lifetime, he held a very tight rein on all of his students who were the rabbis. So in religious matters, he was supreme, and the ultra-Orthodox ideas about divorce and marriage and these things were under his control, under Rabbi Yosef Bar Soloveitchik's control completely. And his students, he had certain major students, so they called the shots in religious matters. But there was still a major element that did not accept his rule in this, and were chafing at the bit to change things. They did not like the ultra-Orthodox approach in marriage and divorce and such things. And they were there. No one got rid of them. They were there. They were silenced by Rabbi Soloveitchik, but when he died, they began to emerge. And there was a great battle that took place. Who would be the, after Dr. Belkin died, Dr. Belkin himself, the president of Yeshiva University, he really built it up to be a great institution, both in Torah learning and in college level. When Dr. Belkin himself was known as the Radiner genius, the genius of Radin, a city in Lithuania. He was known as the genius of that town. He was an extraordinary person. He was a great scholar in Greek matters, and had many different PhDs. He was constantly getting another PhD, a great genius. And people had such respect for him. He would just go to somebody and the man would right away write a huge check. So he was able to build things up. And when he died, there was a question who should be a successor. And everybody knew that the successor would determine which way Yeshiva University would go, to the right or to the left. And it was a terrible battle. I remember then there was a very, very great battle between two rabbis and their supporters, and nobody could, they were equal. No one could win. And finally, the right-wing person won, just barely, and he was put in. And then when he died, this right-wing person died, the environment had changed. Rabbi Soloveitchik had been going for many years now, and somebody was put in. It was the first time a president was not a great Talmudist, and at this point, Yeshiva University is up for grabs. In fact, there was recently a very great change in the Yeshiva in many areas. Their Rabbinical Council of America, which is the Yeshiva University Rabbinical Court, has come under the influence of somebody. I spoke to him, and he came up with a radical ruling, and people came to him for a divorce. He sent them away without a divorce. I called him up. I said, they came to you for a divorce. Why didn't you give them the Jewish get? He says, well, I determined that the whole thing was never married. I never really married. I said, they went to an Orthodox rabbi. There was a regular wedding. There were the regular Orthodox witnesses. And these people are considered married by nearly all rabbis in the world. Why don't you consider them married? So he came with some kind of an excuse, and it ended that he wasn't able to bring me any source for this excuse. This is what's going on at Yeshiva University today, at the very highest level, and the Rabbinical Council of America, the Beis Din. This Gedalia Schwartz is the head of the Beis Din. I spoke to him, and I would personally never accept anything that he does. And if people like him are going to go around and sending married women out to remarry without a proper get, then a lot of rabbis, myself included, will consider their children to be bastards. Mamzerim. So this is obviously a very serious thing, but the interest in modernizing is considered by many rabbis in the Yeshiva University group. This is their great, the great mission, to modernize the Jewish halacha. So they have basically become conservative.